Hola, bienvenidos a nuestra celebración anual del Día de las Madres. Soy Isabel Hawkins, astrónoma del Exploratorium, y hoy tengo el gran gusto de ofrecerles presentaciones sobre el cacao y el chocolate. Porque, por supuesto, ¿a quién no le gusta un chocolatito caliente para celebrar a nuestras mamás en ese día especial y para toda la familia? Hello, welcome to our annual celebration of Mother's Day. I'm Isabel Hawkins. I'm an astronomer at the Exploratorium, and today we have a great pleasure of sharing with you presentations about cacao and chocolate. And of course, who doesn't want to enjoy a nice cup of hot chocolate with our moms to celebrate that special day? We're going to talk about the science of cacao and the cultural aspects of cacao, because it is a very special plant. And also, of course, we know that from cacao comes the delicious chocolate. And also, we will share with you a traditional recipe so that you can prepare that at home. Hablaremos de la ciencia y los aspectos culturales del cacao. Y, por supuesto, sabemos que el chocolate se hace de la planta del cacao, pero vamos a saber todos los detalles. Y también vamos a aprender a hacer una receta tradicional que podemos realizar en nuestras casas para agasajar a la familia y compartir con todos. Hoy tengo el honor de presentarles a dos expertas invitadas, Madeline Weeks y Carla McNeil, de Crew Chocolate. I have the honor to welcome two experts who are joining us today, Madeline Weeks and Carla McNeil of Crew Chocolate. Y vamos a comenzar con Madeline. We're going to begin with Madeline. Bienvenida, Madeline. ¿Cómo estás? How are you?
I'm well. Thank you, Isabel.
Thank you for joining us. I know that you have many years of expertise and having worked with chocolate and cacao in Mesoamerica, and we're delighted to have you here so that you can share your knowledge with me and with our audiences. Thank you so much for joining us. So we're going to start from the very beginning because I am not an expert in cacao, and I'm very curious. Can you please tell us, what is cacao?
That's a great question. Cacao is the raw ingredient for chocolate.
Interesting. And where does it grow? Is it something that in a bush, or, you know, I've actually never seen a plant of cacao.
Yeah, I have some. There we go. It's the overarching term for the plant, the tree, and the scientific name for this tree is actually Theobroma cacao, which is attributed to a Swedish botanist, Carlos Linnaeus, in the 18th century. And that name means fruit of the gods. But actually, this was known to pre-Columbian societies for millennia before and has a very long history of use of cacao.
And so what we're seeing there in this beautiful image, I see some magenta-colored pods that are just protruding directly from the branches. Is that the cacao pod itself?
Exactly. This is a close-up image of the cacao. It's actually a fruit. And you can see when it's cut open that there are all these seeds inside. So people refer to these as the beans, but it's technically seeds inside of the fruit. And they're covered by this sticky, delicious which is actually quite wonderful to eat if you're hungry or just want a snack in the field.
I see. So actually the white part is actually edible. And does it taste at all like chocolate?
No, that's the amazing thing, is the cacao fruit does not actually taste like chocolate. Some people would say it is like a mix of pineapple or tropical fruits. It's a whole different process to get the chocolate flavor that we know today. So like any fruit, these cacao pods begin as flowers, and the flowers grow directly from the trunk of the tree, which is really an unusual sight. If you ever took a look at it, it's like these football-shaped pods growing directly off the trunk. And as you can see, there are so many different colors representing the incredible diversity of cacao. And as you would imagine, picking any ripe fruit, you want it to taste the most flavorful. And so the people picking really have to understand their cacao to pick the ripest fruit. Most people would say that there are three main varieties of cacao, being criollo, forastero, and trinitario. But in reality, there are so many hybrids and at least 10 distinct types of cacao based on genetic mapping.
Interesting. And so the different colors, do they refer to the different subspecies of cacao, or do they represent the level of maturity of the pod?
It could be both. So in this picture, you see an example of all mature fruits because you would only pick it when it's ripe. So here you're seeing an example of different varieties. But as the fruit is ripening, it actually changes colors from one to another. For example, it may go from green to yellow. It would really depend on each cacao.
Do you have a favorite?
I don't have one favorite variety. I'm not at that level of connoisseurship yet.
That's great. They're a beautiful fruit, my goodness.
Definitely. Yeah, the really amazing thing about cacao is it's very particular. It only grows in a narrow band, 10 degrees north and south of the equator. So it would not be growing in the desert of Arizona, for example. And because it requires this high humidity and rainfall and pretty stable temperatures, it means that the plant is actually quite vulnerable to even small fluctuations in precipitation, and especially to changes due to climate change. So what you can see here are there are different ways of actually growing cacao. It may be found from anywhere in the wild to more of a cultivated system. And on the lower image, you see that it's more of a plantation style with these shade trees. And when cacao has other shade trees, it can be considered an agroforestry system, which can have huge social and economic benefits because some of those trees may be like things that can be sold on the marketplace, or they can be eaten like bananas.
So Madeline, tell me about this beautiful image with this forest that I see at the bottom. And you mentioned an agroforestry system. Can you explain a little bit about that?
Sure. Agroforestry is the blending of trees with other crops, and these can be anything from bananas to cardamom to black pepper, which can have huge social and economic benefits to the producers. So what I thought was particularly relevant to today is that in the bottom image is a young cacao farm with shade trees called Madre de Cacao, which are providing some of the shaded protection for those young cacao trees to grow.
That's wonderful. That's very relevant to today. So even in a ecosystem, you have a relationship that's almost a familial relationship, just like we have in our human communities. That's really wonderful. So cacao a fully domesticated plant? And what is the human connection between cacao and people throughout history?
Definitely. And this is where we need to refer to the wisdom of people long before our current society, where cacao trees were actually naturally found in the tropical rainforest of the Maya homeland. And the Maya valued chocolate so much that they gathered these seeds from the rainforest and they started domesticating it by growing it in their own gardens. And these scenes are often shown in ancient glyphs, which is the Maya written language. So another reference to that is in the Popol Vuh, which is the Maya creation text. And in that, it references corn and cacao as intrinsically linked to human connection. And so it's this whole idea of you are what you eat, where that the human body is comprised of the very food. And so corn is symbolic of the human life cycle. And cacao has this very important link between the human and the sacred realm.
Yeah, when I went to Mesoamerica to work on astronomy with Maya colleagues, you know, they definitely were very conversant with the use of cacao, even today in the communities, and the significance both for ritual, ceremony, for daily consumption. And it was really fun to learn from them and to see that the whole culture of cacao is very much alive today in the world where the Mayas still thrive in Mesoamerica, you know, southern Mexico, Guatemala, Belize, Honduras, El Salvador. That was a really wonderful experience for me. And I was able to have some of the traditional cacao drinks at that time. And it was quite different from what I was used to here in the U.S.
Definitely. It's very much an alive and present tradition, including the different uses and different symbolic and other importance of the value of cacao. People may have heard that cacao was used as currency. And in fact, it was used almost like money, in which merchants would use the cacao beans to buy and sell different products across long distances. And in that same vein of being so incredibly valuable, it was used in special occasions and life events, festivals like weddings, birth ceremonies, and even funerals.
Interesting. And now we want to make sure that people remember to honor their moms during Mother's Day with either una tacita de chocolate caliente, ¿verdad? A little mug of hot chocolate, or a bonbon, or some kind of way of honoring the tradition of chocolate in our cultures. This is a beautiful vase. Can you tell us what we're seeing here?
So in that note of the importance of women and cacao, and especially cacao beverages, it's not surprising that we even have ancient evidence of cacao as a sacred beverage. If you take a really close look at this vase, you can make out that there's a woman pouring what looks to be a vessel. And from that, there's something coming out of it. And it's thought that she was a palace servant woman pouring cacao drink from one vessel to another, which may be one of the earliest depictions of this process of foaming up the drink, which is important to emulsify or to incorporate the natural fat of the cacao beans into the liquid.
Interesting. So this is definitely traditional science, right? A lot of times I always reflect on the fact that if in our communities we have a longstanding tradition that has served the community for over generations, then obviously science is part of it. Technology is part of it. Mathematics is part of it, because otherwise it wouldn't have survived and it wouldn't have kept the family thriving, the community thriving. And so, and I had never heard that the fact that when you pour from a high distance a liquid, that it actually causes a chemical reaction to allow the fat to emulsify. I hadn't heard of that. So that's science of cacao right there. That's wonderful. Very interesting fact.
It's really incredible. And that history is very much alive today. As you were saying with your trips with colleagues, this image that's coming up is an example of still pouring the cacao beverage from up high into something below, either using more of a traditional gourd or jicara to even more of a modern cup. And this is an example of a woman in Guatemala. Other traditional beverages are drinks in Mexico. On the very far left, you see tejate, which is typical of Oaxaca, and it's made from corn and cacao, mame seeds, and ground up cacao flowers. And then in the middle is a really, really foamy beverage. You can just see all that foam coming off from Tlaxcala. And on the other side, you can actually see there's a woman, instead of using the method to pour from above to below, she's using a more modern instrument introduced by the Spanish called a molinillo.
Yeah, you can see that she's like going at it and making that foam. Interesting. Yeah, I've had tejate in Oaxaca, actually. Now that you mentioned it, I've forgotten. But it has this very delicious, creamy, buttery top. Mm-hmm. And maybe that's the emulsifying part that you're talking about, and how the women had to put ice and they would just scrape and go around and around to make it come together somehow. So that was really cool to see.
Definitely. It lifts up the soul. And in fact, there's one theory that those bubbles or the foam on top kind of captures parts of the heavens. And so that's one idea of why the foam is so symbolically important.
So it's interesting how, you know, a food, you know, a traditional food in our communities can be so much part of our identity, you know, to the point that it reflects our relationship with place, with the sky, with the natural elements. And there's something really profound on that relationship. And I think that it speaks to a care for the environment, a relationship that is very tangible, and it makes us hopefully better environmentalists, you know, better citizens of the planet. And I know that you've worked with many different communities in Mesoamerica on just this issue of sustainability. So what have been your experiences in that relationship?
Thank you for that question. And I like to think that cacao is what can connect us all. And it's really about understanding that human, starting with our own connection with ourselves, to the history, the living history, to the environmental sustainability aspects. So it's with cacao that you can never stop learning and connecting with various things.
I know that you have years as a professional working on sustainability. You're trained in interdisciplinary social sciences. So you bring this perspective from many different fields that can give you an overall comprehensive picture of not just the plant as a scientific specimen, but the plant in relationship to its environment and to the people. And you did work in Belize, Guatemala, Honduras. And you are also very concerned about the livelihood of farmers, conservation, biodiversity, the importance of biodiversity, and providing economic opportunities, especially for women. So how are things going in Mesoamerica right now, especially with the challenges of the pandemic? Have you seen any particular changes in their strategies or in their relationships with other growers and with the economic component that obviously is very important for their well-being? What have you found?
I've had just a couple of conversations, and so it's not to speak for all of Latin America, but I know that especially at the beginning of the pandemic, food was definitely an issue. Just having access to enough food, and then also having the communication, and you know, whether it's borders becoming closed or having to make very difficult decisions about whether to grow something immediate for the current survival needs or something that's more of a long-term investment, which is cacao, because it can take up to 3 years for the trees to mature. So from very indirect communications, I understand that COVID-19 has been particularly challenging in those parts of the world. At the same time, I do want to highlight their resiliency and how we in the US can also be learning from those attitudes.
Absolutely. I think you're right. When people are very close to the land and understand their environment very intimately, they're much more able to be resilient and to respond to challenges, you know, be climate change or, you know, how to improve the biodiversity or how to feed your, your community. You know, when you know how to grow your own food, that gives you a great advantage that we don't have here in the more industrialized parts of the world. Mm-hmm. But thank you so much for sharing with us these amazing insights and your experience. I think that now we're going to move to the next segment, which is to interview Carla McNeil and her work on Karoo. But then we'll invite you both together again so that we can have a continued discussion. Thank you so much, Madeline.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Ahora tengo el gran gusto de dar la bienvenida a Carla McNeil, quien es la cofundadora de Karoo Chocolate. Es una compañía para la elaboración sostenible del chocolate artesanal. Entonces, bienvenida, Carla.
Muchas gracias, Isabel. Un placer poder estar aquí.
¿Cuál es tu conexión personal con el cacao y qué te inspiró a formar tu propio negocio, Karoo Chocolate?
Pues, personalmente, yo nací y crecí en Honduras y mis abuelos eran agricultores. Crecían de todo, especialmente el café, y el dulce o la panela, como lo llamamos. Entonces, crecí en fincas, en haciendas, crecimos en las áreas rurales. Y eso desde pequeña edad despertó en mí ese interés por la agricultura y ese amor por el poder estar experimentando la vida más natural, un ritmo natural, no como se ve ahora. El nacer ahí lo forma uno de una manera bien diferente, especialmente el deseo por la libertad y también el ver la agricultura como una profesión muy honorable, porque nos damos cuenta de que si no se siembra, pues no se come. Y ese amor que se le despierta a los alimentos desde una edad muy pequeña por el poder sembrarlos y el ver crecerlos. Cuando yo me vine aquí a Estados Unidos, me di cuenta que era un mundo completamente muy diferente. Entonces yo anhelaba esa vida, esa libertad de poder. El día termina cuando el sol, dependiendo del sol, pues no dependiendo de un reloj. Entonces eso me llevó a buscar maneras, porque... buscar maneras de cómo yo podía hacer mi vida aquí. Y en eso encontramos el chocolate. Yo hacía siempre he hecho chocolate en casa. Y una vez mi mamá vino y teníamos amigos y traía el cacao, yo hacía el chocolate y me di cuenta de que todo el mundo, ¡ay, qué barbaridad! No sabían que el chocolate venía de un grano y para mí, de un palo. Y para mí fue como, ¡qué loco! ¿Eh? Yo decía, a lo mejor les caigo bien y están como queriéndome, están que bien educaditos. Pero no, la verdad es que la gente no sabía de dónde venía.
No sabía.
No, y era algo bien mágico para ellos. Y para mí era una tradición, algo muy bonito, como un ritual, algo que lo teníamos que hacer, pero no era algo así. Pues. Entonces cuando vi así, ahí poquito a poco va dando y así va uno... Yo creo que tenemos que tener una idea o un deseo de una vida mejor y la misma vida le va mostrando a uno el camino.
¿Y cuáles son las prácticas sostenibles que ustedes utilizan en Karoo Chocolate?
Ajá, en lo referente a prácticas sostenibles, para mí es más que todo los valores que son muy, que han sido inculcados en nosotros, pues lo que es el respeto a la tierra, el respeto a la gente, el respeto a la tradición. El poder escuchar simplemente, hemos logrado que ahora ya tenemos como muchos productores, la gente que nos envían el cacao, los productores con los que trabajamos, ya han pasado de productores de cacao a fermentadores y luego hasta exportar su propio cacao. Eso ha sido, uh-huh. Es un gran éxito, si usted conoce la industria donde por lo general el productor produce y alguien lo compra y el otro lo fermenta y el otro lo envía, y de aquí que sale el productor lo han tocado muchas personas. Entonces nosotros buscamos esa integración donde el productor de cacao uh-huh. pueda tener más acceso a la uh-huh. cadena sostenible de cacao. Y eso se hace más que todo con relaciones, con confianza. Recoger el teléfono tres veces al día, cómo hacemos esto, cómo llenamos este papel. Entonces son cuestiones que vienen en nuestros valores, el apoyarnos el uno al otro, pero que en nuestros países crean una gran diferencia. El hecho de que un productor pueda soñar también en hacer su propio chocolate y que pueda contar con nosotros aquí en Estados Unidos en proveer equipo pequeño o ayudar con el conocimiento técnico, crea un plan largo sostenible a largo tiempo, porque ahora el productor ya no solo piensa en crecer este cacao y venderlo mañana, sino que ahora piensa, mis hijos tal vez pueden hacer chocolate, y ya cuando empezamos a ver todo a largo plazo, la manera en cómo vemos la vida cambia. Y creo que no solo allá, sino que a el ser humano.
Bueno, Carla, tú eres hondureña, obviamente mesoamericana, y en las culturas mesoamericanas el cacao ha sido muy importante por miles de años. Se utiliza para celebraciones, para hacer bebidas especiales. ¿Qué tipo de tradiciones y rituales tú realizas con el cacao y el chocolate, sobre todo en Clue Chocolate?
Pues las tradiciones y rituales que celebramos empiezan desde el proceso, desde la finca, desde la siembra. Muchos de nuestros agricultores tienen esa tradición, donde antes de poder ir y fermentar y poder recoger el cacao, la cosecha, como decimos, ellos realizan sus rituales, ellos tienen sus oraciones, ellos tienen lo que hacen tradicionalmente por miles de años para poder invitar el buen flujo, la buena suerte o Dios, como la gente lo quiera llamar, pero eso, la buena energía, a que nos dé fuerza para poder seguir trabajando. Para nosotros el uso de rituales y tradiciones pues se muestran más que todo en nuestras recetas, que es muy importante para nosotros el poder siempre fomentar la diversidad y la inclusión de plantas tradicionales con raíces indígenas, pues de donde nosotros venimos. Por ejemplo, usamos el cacao jaguar, usamos mucho el anato, el achiote, usamos mucho la pimienta gorda, todas estas hierbas y especias que usamos mucho flores, usamos como 50 ingredientes en hacer nuestras recetas tradicionales, que me parece que es importante porque el uso y es esa conexión de usarlas y simbiótica entre el uno y el otro, entre el ser humano y las plantas, que mantiene pues estas tradiciones vivas.
Y también mantiene la biodiversidad, o sea, es una cuestión también de sostenibilidad, de ciencia, ¿no? No es tan solo decir, es una costumbre o es una tradición, pero realmente tiene un fundamento científico que ayuda a la biodiversidad de las plantas, que ayuda al medio ambiente y, por supuesto, al bienestar de las comunidades también. Y sobre todo, ahora que es Día de las Madres, ¿no es cierto?, esta celebración tan importante de nuestros seres queridos, ¿cuál es el papel que juega el cacao y el chocolate para unir nuestras familias y nuestras comunidades?
Sí, el cacao y el chocolate son plantas y costumbres tan sensibles que han sido posibles solo con el hecho por la mujer, podemos decir. Por ejemplo, en Honduras estamos trabajando en una comunidad donde antes se ha usado mucho la palma africana. Estos trabajos fuertes que han sido importados, diría pues, o forzados en las comunidades, no permiten el uso del trabajo de la mujer, porque es muy difícil subirse, ¿me entiende?, 20 pies arriba a sembrar. Claro. Entonces, el cacao ha estado ahí presente para la mujer desde el hecho de que es accesible para la manera en cómo nuestros cuerpos están formados. Es un trabajo que requiere el tiempo de la fermentación, es un cacao que requiere el tiempo de la fermentación, y también volvemos a lo que es ritual y tradición. Estas bebidas son muy complejas y requieren... Tradicionalmente las mujeres son las que han sido encargadas de hacer esto y requieren la recolección de no solo el cacao, pero sino de muchas hierbas y semillas, lo que crea este sentimiento de comunidad y de estar el uno con el otro, de probar la bebida del uno, probar la bebida del otro, de que tal vez esta persona tiene la hierba, tal vez la otra no, pero... Eso es lo que ha creado, eso es lo que siento que el cacao trae más que todo, o que la mujer y el cacao han creado juntos, aparte del uso del cacao, porque el uso del cacao siempre está relacionado con la mujer. Cuando, especialmente en el momento del parto, las bebidas de cacao han sido siempre usadas para que podamos poder tener la fuerza para un momento tan pesado. En la nutrición de la familia, las bebidas que se preparan para los niños, tal vez cuando ha habido casos de pandemia, casos de desnutrición, sabemos que nuestras comunidades han pasado por mucho, y son estas bebidas y estas recetas que es un conocimiento que ha sido atraído a través de las mujeres que nos han permitido pues sobrevivir prácticamente, y no solo sobrevivir, pero tener una vida con placer también, porque son deliciosas y se beben en comunidad, y un chocolatito caliente o helado pues ya le da energía a uno para bailar también.
No sé. Claro que sí, sí claro sí. que sí. Sin duda. Y tú estás tratando de fortalecer esta tradición de ingerir el cacao en forma de bebida a través de Crude Chocolate. Y yo sé que nos has hecho un video especial para compartir con nuestras audiencias para que podamos hacer y elaborar una receta a base de cacao para celebrar a nuestras familias y sobre todo a las mamás en el Día de las Madres. Entonces, ¿por qué no nos cuentas un poquito de qué tipo de receta nos vas a demostrar?
Pues la receta que vamos a hacer tiene muchos nombres y como usted sabe, Centroamérica es bien complejo. En Mesoamérica, pues desde el sur de México hasta Nicaragua o Costa Rica, somos muy complejos y cada quien su tradición es su tradición. Entonces, tenemos muchos nombres. Existe el pinol, el pozol, el tiste, el champurrado, el atol. A mí me gusta llamarla, pues, maíz y cacao juntos, porque el maíz y el cacao han evolucionado junto con nuestra cultura y son los pilares fundamentales de lo que es nuestro arte culinario, podríamos decir. Uh-huh. Lo que vamos a hacer aquí es una bebida con un maíz, que en este caso es nixtamalizado, entonces un maíz de masa, para crear una bebida que por lo general la gente aquí en Estados Unidos la llaman champurrado. Ya lleva unas uh-huh. adaptaciones europeas, como ser la leche, como ser la canela, el anís, son plantas que no son nativas de Centroamérica, pero que han encontrado y han sido muy incluidas en nuestra cocina. Entonces, una bebida para de disfrutar en los tiempos de frío.
Qué bueno, qué bueno. Entonces, ahora presten toda atención para aprender a hacer esta bebida a base de maíz y cacao, lo que le llamamos aquí típicamente el atole champurrado. Entonces, Carla nos va a enseñar todos los detalles para que los disfrutemos.
Hello, my name is Carla. I am the founder of Crude Chocolate. And today I would love to show you how to make a traditional cacao and corn drink. This drink has many names across Mesoamerica, meaning Southern Mexico and Central America area, from champurrado, pinol, atole, however you would like to call it. We just want to mix a little bit of corn and a little bit of cacao with spices to make a very nutritious and delicious drink that is been drinking for thousands of years in Central America and still being drink today. The main thing we'll be using 2 full tablespoons of ground masa, 1 ounce of chocolate, and the chocolate is about a 60% blend, meaning 60% cacao, 40% sugar. We'll be using 1 tablespoon of cinnamon, 1/2 tablespoon of anise seed, and 1/2 tablespoon of allspice berries. And we're gonna use 1 cup of milk, plus a little bit more, and 1/2 cup of water. To begin with, we're gonna start by heating our milk. So I'm going to add it here. Just leave a little bit so for later. Chocolate drinks are always made traditionally on clay pots. We're using a micaceous clay pot, but you can use at home whatever you had available. But a clay pot that you decide to use only for chocolate, it becomes a very nice experience when you do it. We're gonna wait for the water to come to a soft boil. And a little bit about the drinks. Chocolate and cacao and corn drinks in Central America are used as a food, not just necessary as a pure drink, but it's mostly like a morning breakfast that you will use as a kind of like a cereal that you will use as a meal. They change within the seasons. The recipe that I'm making right now is more like a winter type of drink where you will use it hot, but you can also use it cold during the summer. We're using a heirloom white corn from Oaxaca. I don't know why I say that. Once the milk starts coming to a soft boil, we're going to add the drinking chocolate. Now open the wheel. This is about 1 ounce of cacao of chocolate. And you're gonna drop it there and it will start melting by itself. At this point, we also will add a little bit of the cinnamon. We'll start adding our spices. Aniseed. And allspice. Once the water starts boiling a little bit, we bring the heat down. And we have our hot milk. You can use any type of milk. You can also use water. A little rest there. And now with your 2 tablespoons of corn, you're gonna mix it with water. We have a cup of water. Though you want the water to be cold so it doesn't curd. Traditionally, this is made by hand because you do wanna make sure that your corn doesn't create little clumps. So you do it by hand. And we have the chocolate and the spices at a very low heat. The flavors are dissolving right now, releasing. And as you see, the corn starts thickening. The main thing is you want to make sure that it doesn't have that clumps. I'm gonna check on the chocolate. Blend with spices. It smells really good. You start whisking it. You can use some molinillo, which is a traditional wooden whisk, or you can use a metal whisk as well. We're using very low heat here. And now we're slowly, we're gonna start adding our corn mixture. In the moment we add it, we want to start moving it. If you have any leftovers here, you can always add a little bit of water to kind of clean it up from the pot. That way you don't waste the corn. We're gonna mix slowly. And at this point, we're gonna add a little bit of heat. You know that chocolate's going to be ready once it starts becoming thick. So we're just gonna add heat until it starts thickening. At this point, you can taste for flavor. So you can see if you need more sugar, if there is a specific spice that you would like to add. Then, as you can see, it starts sticking. You want it to look very silky, very shiny, very beautiful. The mix of cacao and corn for us represents balance, union. Is as you can see, the corn is white, the chocolate is dark. It's that mixture of the underworld and the upper world that come together and are represented in a drink. If you see that plant, the cacao and the corn has certain similarities too, like they both grow out of the stalk of the tree or the cane. So that was very important for the people of Mesoamerica. Corn needs a lot of sunlight, while cacao needs a lot of shade. Corn grows in the plains, while chocolate cacao grows in the trees, on the forest. So you see here, it's thickening. I like it this way. If you want it more like a toll, something that you will have to eat more like a kind of like a custard, you can keep it a little bit hot. And you want to break the first boil. So as you see there, that's the first boil there. So at this point, you just stop the fire. You're gonna let it rest for like 5 minutes because it's super hot. But if it is super cold outside, you wanna serve it right now, as it's very nice to hold a drink in your hands and wait until it, you know, it's ready to drink. It's kind of makes you, it warms you up. To serve it, you serve it into small cups. And when I serve it, I like to add a dash of milk. And a little bit of cinnamon. This is a beautiful drink that you can do with the people you love, your mother, your family, your daughters, your friends, for those cold nights or mornings. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Carla. And now again, we welcome Madeline for one last little reflection together, because I know that you two are very close colleagues and friends mm-hmm. and have spent many, many months or even years in Mesoamerica learning together about sustainable practices of cacao and chocolate. So I wonder if you might share with us a story or experience from your collaborations, and especially your work with Indigenous women in Mesoamerica and also here in the Bay Area. So the floor is yours.
Thank you so much. I met Madeline since we first started in our chocolate company. She reached out. She was at UC Davis at that moment. And it's been a long journey, but here we are. And she's been an amazing person for us to connect. Even she created a connection for us to go to Guatemala and help give classes of how to make chocolate, or share how we make chocolate here with the women and the Cachique women in Guatemala, and learn from them. And from then, we've been working together now. And now the farmers are not just growing their cacao, but they're fermenting it. Now they are their own exporters, and now they are actually making chocolate. And the mm-hmm. women have their own company. So it's been a very beautiful relationship. That is just thank you, Madeline, for doing the introduction and facilitating that.
Oh, thank you, Carla. No, it's. I think that we've come together through our love of chocolate, and it's amazing to see how that has flourished as a relationship and started really amazing things. For me, one of the most incredible moments is a memory of sitting with the producers in Guatemala after the second day of a workshop that you had led, Carla, of doing different recipes using cacao. Like the pinole as one of the recipes, the granola. But what I really remember was sitting for lunch and sharing a meal of, mm-hmm. I think it was tortillas and chicken soup, and just having that sense of common ground with everybody and that ability to connect either through our conversation, but just the shared understanding that the cacao and the food and the corn was what was bringing everybody together.
Mm-hmm. And it's very beautiful too, because you know that Quechua is the native language of the people in Guatemala. Mm-hmm. So they don't speak Spanish, and I don't speak Quechua, neither Madeline. So they, it's kind of, we're both at the same struggle to understand what's going on and communicate. So that has helped us see it different too.
Yeah,
I think you found a common language, the common language of cacao, right? Yeah. And food and nourishment and women and collaboration. I want to congratulate you both. You're doing amazing work. You're inspiring me so much to learn more about cacao, about our traditional beverages. And I really thank you for your expertise, for your time, and for sharing all your wonderful knowledge about chocolate and cacao. And I hope that you can celebrate Mother's Day in your own way with your families, and have a wonderful rest of the week and a wonderful Sunday in which we can bring together all of the love that we carry for our cultures and our families. So thank you so much to both of you.
Thank you.
Thank you.